Dr. Yehuda Schoenfeld is the head of the Department of Medicine at the Tel Aviv University since 1984. Dr. Schoenfeld founded and is heading the Center for Autoimmune Diseases at the largest hospital in Israel, the Sheba Medical Center. Recently, he has opened the new Zabludovic Center for Autoimmune Diseases. His topic is ASIA, Autoimmune Syndrome Induced by Adjuvant, a new syndrome to be defined.
Thank you very much, Raymond. I would like also to thank very much the organizer for bringing me from the Holy Land. I believe that I am the one who traveled the longest way from Israel to Jamaica. And another aspect that I have to say that I've been almost all over the world except of Jamaica, so now I can put a V over Jamaica too. Just first to present myself. I am a clinician. I am a head of the Department of Medicine during the last 28 years, and I'm still using the archaeological equipment called stethoscope every day. The second point is that I regard myself as an autoimmunologist. It's a new profession. I am a clinical immunologist on top of being an internist, but being an autoimmunologist is a person who deals with different autoimmune diseases, from Crohn's disease to multiple sclerosis, from polymyositis, an inflammation of the muscles, to uveitis, which is an autoimmune condition of the eye. The reason why I regard myself as an autoimmunologist is because all autoimmune diseases are the same. All of them have similar or same factors, even though they are multifactorial. So to develop an autoimmune disease, you need to be born to the proper father and mother. You need the genetic background. And we will see that also with what we are talking about, we will have to have a very strong genetic background. So this will be one of the major risk factors, to be born to the proper father and mother. By the way, if you will live long, it also depends, among other things, on being born to somebody who has a father who outlived to the age of 95 or 100. The second important factor in all autoimmune diseases are the hormonal factors. And this is the reason why most autoimmune diseases are more prevalent among females than men. Some of them may have 10 to 20 times more prevalent among female than men, and especially during the childbearing ages. And this is the hormonal issue. We do know that estrogen can actually enhance the immune system, and that's the reason why many of the autoimmune diseases start when the girl gets her first menstruation. They have some kind of aggravation during pregnancy or when you take contraceptives. The third, and there are other hormones which are extremely important, among them are prolactin or even vitamin D that were mentioned here at the beginning of our session. The third factor are actually immune factors, or let's call them immune deficiencies. We do know that there are many factors which will make you prone to develop an autoimmune disease. For instance, one of the very common among them are IgA deficiency, which, if you will go even in Jamaica among the 3 million population, you will find that one out of 600 healthy subjects just swimming in the sea, they have IgA deficiency. Those who have IgA deficiency, they will be more prone to develop infections. They will be more prone to develop allergies. They will be more prone to develop autoimmune diseases, and by the way, also increased in the incidence of cancer. So IgA deficiency is just one of an array of different immune deficiencies or immune defects which will make you to be prone to develop an autoimmune disease. And last but not least, you need a trigger mechanism, something that will decide that you will develop the disease on 4th of July or 12th of September. And there are hundreds of different environmental factors which will induce autoimmune disease. The most prevalent are we, the physicians, drugs. There is almost no drug that cannot induce autoimmune diseases, even though there are some which are more notorious than other to induce the disease. There is even one drug which is not anymore in use, which was able to induce 11 different autoimmune diseases. But the second most prevalent environmental factors are infectious agents. Some of them are bacteria, some of them are viruses. For instance, one of the notorious viruses are EB virus, Epstein-Barr virus, which can induce also 12 or 20 different autoimmune diseases. However, relating to the lecture of Pavelski, which I would say that I do not agree with him in 98% of what he said, but I didn't want to discuss it because it would have taken all the time of my 3 hours time dedicated to my talk. So in any case, there are good bugs, we know it. And indeed, they differ, as you will see in my talk. Some of the drugs may cause one autoimmune disease and then protect against another autoimmune disease. Now think about the diversity. You need the genetic background. And again, I will show you that some genes protect you from autoimmune disease. And this is the reason why, if you go in one family, you may have the mother having lupus, the daughter may have type 1 diabetes mellitus, and the son is completely healthy. And that's the reason, because he has a protective genes. And by the way, we have protective bacteria or viruses, we have protective genes, but we have also pathogenic bacteria and pathogenic genes. And this shows you how diverse are autoimmune diseases. And despite that, coming from the Holy Land, I have to say that God protects us. That's a very important factor. And the reason that autoimmune diseases, despite all these factors, are quite rare. We do have about 80 classical autoimmune diseases. And to show that something is an autoimmune, we have rules to show that it's autoimmune. So therefore, for instance, Claire, asthma is not an autoimmune disease. Having said that, there is a fraction of asthmatic patients which fulfill the criteria or partially fulfill the criteria of autoimmune diseases. So this is just as a background to what I mean to be an autoimmunologist, is to deal with all aspects of different autoimmune diseases, because the factors are similar and the therapies are similar. So if we have one successful biological therapy for Crohn's disease, immediately the physician will apply it, for instance, for uveitis, and it will work. So it shows you that only the symptomatology will differ from one disease to the other. And this is the logic behind instituting what I did in Israel, a huge center for autoimmune diseases in which different patients, I would say patients with different autoimmune diseases will be diagnosed. So we have a service of autoimmune diseases, a lab. We have the different patients, the gastroenterologist, the ophthalmologist, or the pulmonologist sitting in the same center. We have also a daycare to treat all these kind of diseases with the same biologists. We gain a lot of experience with that. And last but not least, we have also a research center or a research lab at the same center. So it's a unique center so far in the world, and we already have visitors from different countries to learn this concept of autoimmunologists, like we have gastroenterologists, like we have infectiologists, and so forth and so forth. So now, how did I come to the story of the vaccines? Being an autoimmunologist and dealing with patients as well as doing basic research, I was called by lawyers to defend or to support some claims for vaccine-induced autoimmune diseases. And I saw it as a challenge. First of all, I'm the son of a lawyer. So I said, if I couldn't be a lawyer, I'm just a simple physician, I will try to imitate and to see if I can be a lawyer too. But I saw it as a challenge to see whether I can convince the lay people, and lawyer, where is Cohn, Dr. Cohn, the lay people, if I can convince them that vaccine can be one of the many factors which may induce autoimmune diseases. And I gained a lot of experience. I have appeared many times in the US courts, I've appeared in other courts, including in my country and sometimes in Norway and so forth. In some of the cases, I won. I was able to convince the special master, the judge, that indeed there was a cause and effect relationship. It was not so difficult because there are rules how you have to show the cause and effect relationship. There is one judge which never ever I was able to convince him that there is an association, because he came, in my opinion, by a predefined decision that there is no cause whatever I will say. And I have to say it was an unfair discussion, because I'm the scientist, I'm the physician, and he's not. But he ruled out anything that I said for as a cause and effect between vaccine and autoimmunity. But these people, those who supported my ideas and those who were against my idea, opened my eyes. And suddenly I have realized that maybe we're having a mistake, because in many of the court appearances, they wanted me to show that this is a real, well-defined autoimmune disease. If it's lupus, it should fulfill or fill the 4 out of 11 criteria. And in many of the cases, I knew that it's lupus. It's a lupus-like disease, so it will be a lupus in a year. But if it was 3 out of 11, he or she said, listen, it's not lupus. So if it's not lupus, you don't have a case, because you said vaccine-induced autoimmune disease. The second point that I have realized, that we made a critical historical mistake. When I say we, it's maybe we the physicians, but also the judges. They wanted always that I will show the cause and effect relationship if it was 21 days. If it was 22 days, so it's not a cause and effect relation. And maybe it's not 21 days, maybe it was 2 months, but 2 months and 3 days, there is no cause and effect relationship. And that opened my eyes, and eventually, as you will see later on, I realize that there are other conditions in, so to speak, autoimmunity, which are very similar to vaccine-induced autoimmunity. And practically, when I looked on the clinical manifestations, they were very similar. So this gave the impetus to what we call the Escher syndrome. I think that it went too quickly. This brought the idea to Escher syndrome. Now, Escher, because, you know, Israel is on the western part of Asia, but in addition, whatever I tried to use the acronym, nasty things came up, like Nazi names, etc. So I decided, let's have Escher, and I think that it caught among my friends and so forth, so it's called autoimmune syndromes, not one syndrome, induced by adjuvants, not by adjuvant, by one adjuvant. So it involves also vaccine-induced, and as you will see, autoimmune diseases, but eventually you will see that not necessarily they are autoimmune diseases, but it may be autoimmunity, and it may be an auto-inflammatory condition. And this is just advertisement. We need advertisement in our presentation, the 8th International Congress of Autoimmunity, which I do know that we will have at least 1 or 2 sessions dedicated to the vaccine and autoimmunity. And I promise you that I will bring pro and cons at the same session. So these are the other meetings that we are organizing. Now, I would like to start from the clinical part of view, point of view, and I will show you just 4 or 5 slides about one autoimmune condition. It's called vasculitis. Vasculitis is actually inflammation of the blood vessels. It's a systemic disease. It may involve the brain, the gastrointestinal tract, the lungs, the heart, the muscle, and so forth. So these are 4 a presentation. These are just case reports, only case reports, in which the author, different authors, believe that there is some kind of an association between a vaccine and the appearance of the inflammation of the muscles. And you can see that all of them involve, as you can see, different vaccine. Here it's the vasculitis, which was induced by influenza vaccine. This is by typhoid vaccine. And here we had by BCG that we heard today so much about it. And all of them are vasculitides. They differ in their presentation. Cryoglobulinemia, by the way, is prevalent where the mafia is prevalent, namely in Italy. But if you go to the north, in the Nordic countries, you almost cannot find cryoglobulin. Why? You will see later, no? Because in the mafia, you intermarriage your friends, etc. So you keep the same dangerous and risk genetic factors in comparison to what happened in the Nordic Arctic. These are another four cases, as you will see. All of them were caused by meningococcal vaccine. So this is, and you see the purpureal inflammation. These are spots which are caused by semi-clotting in the area. And all of them were generated by meningococcal vaccine. And last but not least, another different situation in which we have just inflammation of the superficial vessels, all of them caused by influenza vaccines. And this is just a summary that we have done about four adult patients. In all of them, there was a specific autoantibody, the pathogenic autoantibody which caused the inflammation. And these four cases actually join another 33 cases. So this is one of the problems, to convince the medical world that indeed vaccine may be one of the factor, environmental factor, which cause full-blown autoimmune condition, because most of the reports in the literature were just case report, because it depends on the attention of the physician and if he takes the good past history to associate it with the vaccine. By the way, most of autoimmune diseases are caused by infections. So it's difficult also to demonstrate that the infection causes. For instance, polyarteritis nodosa, which is one of these inflammatory conditions of the vessels, in 97% you will have hepatitis C in your body. So it's very easy to associate hepatitis C. But in other cases, it might be just urinary tract infection with a bacteria called Klebsiella. Who among the physicians asked the patient, did you have urinary tract infection 3 months ago? Every lady had a urinary tract infection 3 months ago. So it's very difficult to demonstrate the cause and effect relationship. So this might be the reason why influenza vaccine may be safe, may be effective. I know that many people will hear say that it's not, but it's mistrusted. And this is the reason why in the last epidemic of the swine flu, also in my hospital, I have to say that less than 50% of the staff received the immunization. So I don't want to frighten people by saying that vaccine can cause autoimmune disease. I'm still a believer that in many cases the vaccine are the best thing that happened to humanity. That's what I think as a physician. And I do not agree with many of the non-scientific declarations that were here. And we have to be very careful. If you want to convince in something, do not just declare things without having the scientific support. I want just to draw the attention of the physician to ask more proper question to find out what is the real prevalence between vaccine and autoimmunity, autoimmune conditions or diseases, and autoinflammatory conditions. Now, this is the main diagram that I'm being recognized by that because of our first book that I published already in 1989, which is called The Mosaic of Autoimmunity. So you see that you need different genetics and specifically the genetic markers, which are called HLA. There are other. You need some immune defect. I talked about IgA deficiency, but there are many. For instance, if you suffer from a complement deficiency, which is one of the factors in our immune system, and specifically C2 and C4, whatever they are, you are at a great risk of developing autoimmune diseases. Actually, all the people in the world, including in Indonesia, who suffer from C1q deficiency, all of them develop systemic lupus erythematosus. That's to show you the closeness of the association between immune defects and autoimmune diseases. These are the hormonal factors we have talked about. I will not talk now about vitamin D, just to explain why, when you go farther away from the equatorial, you have increased incidence of autoimmune disease. It's just the amount of exposure to the sun, the UV radiation, and the amount of vitamin D. And we do know today that the best way to prevent autoimmunity today, which is very cheap and quite effective, is to take tablets of vitamin D in high dosages, more than 2,000. And even myself, I take 2,000, and all my family take. It's good also for heart disease. It's good for to prevent cancer. It's good to prevent infections. So why not to take vitamin D? It's cheap. It has no side effect, and it's effective. And last but not least, here you can see the different aspect. And today, I will speak especially about the adjuvants. So today we know that if you want to encounter an autoimmune disease or get an autoimmune disease, you need the combination of environmental factors together with a genetic background. Otherwise, you will not develop the disease. And this is why most autoimmune diseases are rare. And that's the reason, eventually I will say, why autoimmune diseases are rare also following vaccine. And those who would like to read more about this interaction, they are referred to our paper, Infection and Autoimmunity in Trends of Immunology, which is a very respectful journal. So just to give you an example, if somebody carrying the HLA-DR15, and he meets the EB virus, the notorious virus that I spoke before, he or she will develop a deleterious disease called multiple sclerosis. But if he or she are lucky to inherit the HLA-DR3, which, by the way, is more common, they will develop a very mild, I would say mild autoimmune disease, thyroid autoimmune disease, thyroiditis, or Hashimoto thyroiditis. So it depends what is your genetic background to develop each one of that diseases. As I mentioned, there are also protective HLA. So if you will have one HLA, you will get the disease. If you don't have this HLA, you will not get the disease. So now I would like to go to our subject, and this is the adjuvants and autoimmunity. This is a paper that we have published recently in Lupus, which is called Adjuvant and Autoimmunity. These are my beautiful colleagues. And I would like just to describe what is adjuvant, even though there are experts here who knows better than I do what is adjuvant. And one of the famous ones is alum. So the role of adjuvant is to enhance the immune system to the ingredient which is incorporated in this adjuvant. By the way, the most famous adjuvant in the world is a bacterial construct, which is what is called Freund adjuvant, which comes from Mycobacteria tuberculosis, from the bacteria which cause tuberculosis. So actually what they are supposed to do is to increase the immunogenicity to induce antibodies or to induce the immune system in the cell arm, because we have the humoral arm, the autoantibodies, and the cell arm. So what the adjuvant is doing, it protects the antigen, whatever is the antigen, from being degraded, as you can see. But it also activates from the side the innate immune system. We have two kinds of immune system, the acquired immune system, but we have also the innate immune system. So this is the first line that is exposed to the bacteria, viruses, or the antigen. And somehow, these adjuvants, what they do, they stimulate receptors, and there are many receptors. Right now, we know that there are 13 different toll-like receptors in which the adjuvants can stimulate these receptors to enhance the immune reaction against the antigen. And you cannot see, but most of the natural components in the world which can stimulate this innate system belong to bacterial or viral components. So you have your DNA, RNA, or lipopolysaccharide, which is the toxin which are secreted by most gram-negative bacteria. So that's actually what the adjuvants are doing. Now, interestingly enough, there is a guy, you can see him here finishing the marathon run in New York. He's a very well-established professor, rheumatologist in the USA, and all his career was achieved by publishing what adjuvant, how they cause autoimmune diseases. So what he did, he took just different animal species and just vaccinated and immunized them with adjuvant, different adjuvant. So he summarized his work in Cell 2009, but he had many, many papers about it. And what he was able to show that just by injecting these adjuvants like Pristen or Squalene, which are very famous adjuvant, he can induce any autoantibodies that exist in the world. Any autoantibodies. Now, if you have an autoantibodies, it's a friction between, or it's a small, I would say, time period until you will develop an autoimmune disease. This we have learned recently in a paper in the unknown journal called New England Journal of Medicine, which the people in Oklahoma showed that patients who developed eventually autoimmune disease, they had the autoantibodies sometimes 10 years, sometimes 15 years before they developed the full-blown picture of the disease. But he was clever enough to follow these mice or rats or rabbits, and what he was able to show that these animals, when they were adjuvanated or they just were immunized with adjuvant without a specific antigen, they were also able to develop clinical manifestation. In this case, it was a clinical manifestation of SLE, and again, everything is summarized here. Now, these adjuvants are quite prevalent in nature. I don't know if you are aware that the mineral oil material can be found in different canned foods. So it's quite prevalent that I would say many of the autoimmune diseases that we are encountering as physicians were induced by food that we are eating, not necessarily by injecting the mineral oil, as you can see, and you can see here. Now, there was an historical study which was done by Noel Rose, who is regarded as one of the fathers of autoimmune diseases. When he was young and beautiful, what he did in 1958, he took thyroglobulin. It means he took an autoantigen, a component of our body, and emulsified it in incomplete formed adjuvant. So it's not the complete adjuvant, it's incomplete formed adjuvant. And he was able to show that the rabbits that he immunized or with the adjuvant, they developed autoantibodies but no disease. But once he added the complete adjuvant, as he did here, the rabbits developed actually the full disease. And what recently he showed in a paper was that practically all the bacteria and viruses that we encounter in our life, they are also adjuvants. So we are talking about something that is really very ubiquitous in inducing autoimmune disease. If you will remember that I've said that all autoimmune diseases are induced by infection. Actually, I'm known in the literature as somebody who says that everything is autoimmune until proven otherwise. But I've changed my slogan now following all this information and my lecture on infection and autoimmunity, that everything is infectious until proven otherwise. So can vaccine react as adjuvant and induce autoimmunity? You have seen this picture before, and I would like to draw your attention to the sentence saying that vaccines are still considered the most effective health intervention ever developed, even better than antibiotics. So in any case, what is the evidence that indeed the vaccine can cause rheumatological diseases, because most of the rheumatological diseases are autoimmune diseases like SLE. So the first evidence was in 1948 when a student nurse was given the typhoid and paratyphoid vaccine, and she developed eventually SLE. There were three cases very similar to this one. Then there were more wide range of autoimmune phenomena reported in different vaccines, like the appearance of different autoantibodies and where he bear it. I ask you today why it's only anti-beta 2, but my question was not directed why it's only beta 2, because I believe that if you will examine your children, you will find other autoantibodies. But why the attack is by anti, not beta 2, by anti-beta cells antibodies. So there are some. There is some evidence which nobody can oppose it, even among those who do not believe that vaccine can cause autoimmune disease. And this is the report, again, in the unknown journal, New England Journal of Medicine, 1998, when the swine influenza vaccine was given, and there was a significant increase in Guillain-Barré syndrome. I would mention Guillain-Barré syndrome is a neurological condition of paralysis of the legs, or sometimes it goes to the upper part of the body. And there was no question about it. Actually, there was a second paper in New England Journal of Medicine about 10 years afterward, showing that when they changed something in the vaccine, there was less induction of Guillain-Barré syndrome, but still it was higher than in the regular population where you know the prevalence of Guillain-Barré syndrome. Also with the polio vaccine, we know that it induces transverse myelitis. There was no question about it. This was recognized also by the National Academies of the United States and by Institute of Medicine. It is well recognized and quite prevalent that subject who receive the DTP and the rubella vaccine will develop arthritis. Actually, we know that sometimes patients with rubella, the native rubella, they develop arthritis. So it's not surprising that if you take this virus ingredient, you put it into adjuvant, you will enhance this reaction or maybe even increase the incidence of this arthritis. There are other associations, as you can see here, and there are some which are questionable, despite the fact that we had the wonderful talk by Bert about Haemophilus influenza and the IDDM. I will just skip it. Now, another mistake that I found when I presented things in court was that the judges or the special master wanted always the mechanism. Really? So I will rush. So they wanted the molecular mimicry mechanism, but unfortunately, in most of the cases, there is no molecular mimicry mechanism. This is an example of a molecular mechanism between the jejunal LPS and the Guillain-Barré syndrome, so I will skip it. So the second thing that they want to show causality. Now, how do you show causality? You need to go to animal models, and we have heard about it in the morning. There are several classical animal models. First of all, in dogs, then in mice, in rats, and even in salmon, who are grown in wild and farm as we will say salmon. So a veterinarian noted that dogs, after being vaccinated, they complained about different complaints, or maybe their owners complained about different complaints. And when he examined 20 dogs that he immunized with different vaccine, he found a panoply of autoantibodies. One of them, for instance, anti-laminin, which is a classical autoantibody in SLE. This is, by the way, my dog was not vaccinated in this case. But let's go to the salmon study. This was a wonderful study in this farm-grown salmon, which was published in Journal of Immunology, quite a respectful journal. And they did all the groups that even I believe Beatrix will be happy with the controls. And what they found that the salmons who were vaccinated with the vaccine developed different autoantibodies. Among them, you can see very notorious antibodies like anti-double stranded DNA, which is associated with SLE, and anti-beta 2 GPI, which is associated with clotting in the antiphospholipid syndrome. So when he PM'd his salmons, he found remarkable pathological lesion, as you can see here, with thrombi. I spoke about coagulation, and also kidney lesion, which resembled very much the kidney lesion that you can see in SLE. So then he published another paper in the journal Lupus, and he was able to show that some of the salmons have changes in their bones, which are joints, which resemble very much the panus-like changes that you can see in rheumatoid arthritis. Another model, a very nice model, is in alopecia areata. It's baldness, but you don't have hair anywhere in your body. And I have to say that the NIH gave a lot of money to study this peculiar autoimmune condition because it's very accessible for biopsies, because it's in the skin, so you can analyze it. And indeed, the autoantigen was found. There were many reports to show that the alopecia developed following hepatitis B vaccine. So somebody used a model, an animal model for alopecia, a natural, spontaneous model which developed the alopecia areata and vaccinated the rats. And as you can see, the rats who were vaccinated with hepatitis B developed the alopecia earlier than the placebo group. By the way, we are doing very similar huge study in our laboratory in which we take lupus mice and we vaccinate them just to see if the kidney lesion and the other lesions just appear earlier than the non-vaccinated. Now the second point that I wanted to talk about is a temporal association. As I mentioned, and here I had a lot of criticism about what Dr. Pavelski said, in regular immune system we have the primary response, we have the secondary response, and this is the basis for the vaccine, that the secondary response is much more stronger and this protects you, and this is the idea behind the vaccine. Nobody mentioned it here. And so what happened is that the secondary response is quicker and usually it takes about the first response about 2 to 3 weeks. And this is the idea why the judges and the special master are looking for this period of 21 days to show the cause and effect relationship. There is another reason, because when you take the classical autoimmune disease rheumatic fever, and the rheumatic fever always appears 3 weeks after the streptococcal infection. So they want the 3 weeks of rheumatic fever because the molecular mimicry between the streptococcal envelope and the different organs involved in rheumatic fever are exactly 3 weeks. But we know that, as I mentioned before, and this is again a paper in the unknown journal, New England Journal of Medicine, showing that autoantibodies may proceed by years. There is some kind of a long incubation time, as well as there are other studies which I show here. For instance, when you follow patients who were vaccinated for flu and you measure autoantibodies, some of them appear only after 6 months. So there is some kind of an incubation period of the vaccine in which they induce the autoantibody. These are studies that when hepatitis B vaccine were shown to associate with multiple sclerosis, they were criticized very much. But if you follow these patients after 3 years, a paper that was published in Neurology, you can see that after 3 years there was a close association between those who developed the hepatitis, developed multiple sclerosis, and those who received the hepatitis B virus. The same story appeared also with the papilloma virus vaccine. We have talked about it too much today, and you can see in the paper recently in JAMA in 2009, they showed that only after 2.5 years of follow-up, the patient developed, and I want to draw your attention to Guillain-Barré syndrome, transfer myelitis. So you can see that most of the manifestation were neural manifestation. So I will skip this and I will skip this, and let's go to the possible mechanism. What are the mechanisms by which vaccine can induce autoimmunity? There are different aspects of the vaccine, and somebody already talked about it. We have the antigens of the bacteria, of the viruses, mimicking the regular virus, and by that also mimicking some of the ingredients of our body constituents. But there are also the preservatives, and we have also the adjuvant. And as I mentioned, there are many mechanisms by which adjuvant increase the immune reactivity. So I went to my colleagues in my laboratory, and I asked them, listen, go to the literature, screen the literature, and find which vaccine was never, ever reported to associate with any autoimmune effect or autoinflammatory. And they came with one vaccine, and it's Novavax. And Novavax is the only vaccine which does not contain adjuvant. Isn't it interesting? There is another aspect to it. The Novavax can induce protective autoantibodies. But this is a completely different aspect. I don't want to confuse you. But the pneumovax can induce something which is also pneumococcus, which means protective antibodies. And this is, again, complementing, criticizing the talk of Palevsky. So now I would like to move very short, because we will hear an extensive talk from Romain. When I read his papers, I had another inspiration, because he showed very clearly that a macrophage myofasciitis is associated with the adjuvant and specifically the alum. And these are some pictures which I've taken from his book, but I would like you to draw against your attention to the clinical manifestation. Myalgias, chronic weakness, severe weakness, and sometimes also neurological manifestation. If I remember well, in your first paper, you published that a third of the patients developed eventually multiple sclerosis. And the time period, again, was not 21 days or 2 months or 3 months. It came up to 8 years. So it shows that there is a long incubation time. This is the paper that I discussed with you about the appearance of macrophage myofasciitis in children. It came out from Israel. So the very important contribution of Romain to our understanding of this effect is that he found that there is a genetic preponderance. And this is exactly the same as in infection and autoimmunity. You need to have a specific gene or genes to encounter it. And luckily enough, that's the reason why the side effects are quite rare. And he found that, and we will come back to this HLA later on. I will go just very briefly to the silicon story and the adjuvant of the serum, because it's the same story as with vaccine. Now, the first report about silicon-induced autoimmune disease came from Japan. You know that the Japanese ladies have slanted eyes and small teeth. And they want big teeth like the westernized women. So this is the most prevalent operation in Japan. And very soon after the operation was practical in Japan, 9 cases were reported in the very respectful rheumatological journal, Arthritis Rheumatism, of systemic sclerosis. Hardening of the skin in this subject, in which, by the way, the silicone implant ruptured. So we see that it's more in the ruptured silicone, and especially when the surgeon cannot clean out the silicone, and it happened in some of our cases, in which the silicone spread to the thorax, to the lungs, and nobody was able to extract it. So as you can see, soon afterward, a series of 100 cases of symptomatic women with brain implants were reported in a journal. And as you can see, the incubation time was 6 years, as you can see. And the symptoms are, again, chronic weakness, fatigability, unrefreshing sleep, etc., and also some neurological manifestation. And just recently, I just talked with one of my friends who is an expert on Sjögren's syndrome. He said, yes, we also published several cases of Sjögren's syndrome following this a silicone implant. We have studied asymptomatic patients with silicone implants whom there was no rupture, no complaints, and we found that those who were asymptomatic had already autoantibodies. But those who had ruptured silicone, they had higher incidence of different autoantibodies. And there were cases in which the silicone implant was explanted, and interestingly enough, all the manifestation disappeared. And the most interesting thing is, again, to the HLA or the MHC, and now you see why I photograph plates and so forth. And again, the HLA, which was the most prominent, was the HLA-DRB1, the one that also Romain found in his case of macrophage myofasciitis, as you can see, HLA-DRB1. So the genetic is extremely important, and this is why we are lucky that this manifestation and this clinical condition are not so prevalent. So what we did, we just plated all the clinical manifestation. I didn't detail about the Gulf War syndrome and other conditions like chronic fatigue syndrome or the sick building syndrome. They have all in common, and the common denominator are the clinical manifestation and the adjuvant effect, which is a chronic stimulation of the immune system. Now, I wondered why there is the fatigue and why there is CNS involvement, and we will hear, I believe, from Romain about it, because the aluminium or nanoparticles of the aluminium can actually wander in the body and enter the brain, and we will hear from other speakers about the damage of aluminium to the brain. So what we did, last but not least, I have taken 114 medical records from lawyers. This is totally biased population, because this subject went to get money compensation from the government, and we have taken 93, which we could exclude different things. I will not go into this paper. And interestingly, when we looked on the different conditions, as you can see, many of the patients have full-blown autoimmune disease, because the lawyer did not take just chronic fatigue or cases of headache, but there were still 8 cases out of these 93 who had chronic fatigue syndrome. But you see that the classical autoimmune diseases prevailed. But again, like with autoimmune diseases, women outnumbered the male subject, as you can see, and the onset was not necessarily the 21 days, because it was the average of 43. I believe that, again, the lawyer excluded cases of 2 years or 3 years exposure before. But when we looked about for the different clinical manifestation, you can see that the neurological manifestation prevailed very much. So I will just go very quickly. And just to summarize the story. So we have infections, we have vaccines, we have silicone, we have the Gulf War syndrome, we have the MMF, and most probably also chronic fatigue syndrome or the sick building syndrome. What they have in common is the adjuvant, the chronic stimulation of the immune system, which induces most probably cytokines, which are responsible for the chronic fatigue, and they are also infiltrating into the brain to induce the damage in the brain. Because I came from the Holy Land, I decided that I will finish with description of 5 Jews who changed the world. If you remember, the first one was actually Moses. And Moses was a wonderful person, I have to say, but a terrible navigator. He wandered in the desert for 40 years and then landed in the only country in the area where there is no gas or oil. That's why we are so poor. The second one, but he said that law is above everything. Jesus, who was a wonderful Jewish guy, was born in Nazareth. He said love is above everything. He also changed the world, no question. And then the next one was Marx. He was most probably American and not Russian. He said money is above everything. Who was the next one? Uh-huh. Yes, the next one was Freud. He said sex is above everything. But who was the last one? Do you want to say? Yes, Einstein. He said everything is relative. So what you can see, when I wandered in front of the National Academy of Sciences, I saw this huge statue of Einstein, where I saw his book on the knees, and I came closer, and I found that everything is infectious until proven otherwise, including the vaccine and including this red wine and white wine. So we should dance, we should be happy, and we should take rest. Thank you very much for your attention.